And when you and I have that little something, no matter what it is, well, Pastor, I can organize a little bit. That's good. Well, Pastor, I have the gift of health. I enjoy serving people. That's good. Well, Pastor, I think that when I pray, my prayers are being answered. I'm seeing people heal. That's good. But I've only done it once or twice in my life. You take what you have and give it to Jesus. And when he touches your heart and asks you to surrender that gift to him, don't recoil, but say, how can I help you? How can I serve you? And so Jesus wants you and I to use what we have and turn it over into his hands. And the Bible's clear. Jesus did it in Matthew, and here in 2 Kings, it's evident that he'll take it, he'll multiply it, and he'll do great things with that we surrender over to him. Let the church say amen. Amen. So she said, accept the little oil. And then notice what Elisha says in verse number 3. Go around and ask your neighbors for an empty jar. Don't just ask for a few. Now this is important in sermon, and sometimes I like interaction from the congregation. So I want you to answer. Just talk back to me now. Feel free. Those of you that that feel comfortable doing this. Why did God just not bless the woman instantly with wealth? Why does he make her go through this process of getting the oil? Talk to me. Want her to participate. Good job, Ted. What else?
Lord helps those who help themselves.
In a fashion. Yes. What else? Yes.
Having
faith. Yes.
Obedience.
Obedience. Yes.
Keep your faith.
Keep your faith. Yes.
Faith requires action.
That's good stuff. Yeah. That's good stuff. Even if God didn't just did it. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. He just spoke and the world came into existence. God provided for the children of Israel when they came out of Egypt. He just spoke and the quail came down and bread from heaven just came from the skies. God can do instantaneous miracles anytime on demand with his power. But sometimes he makes you and I participate in the miracle. So he had it in this case. The prophet had the wisdom of God. He got the word of knowledge that he told that dear sister to go use the oil that she had. How was she going to use the oil that she had? How was she going to see a miracle? She had to go to work and go get some empty jars. So here's the part of the community, the part of the story I want to just take a minute. It took the community of people around her to help her experience her miracle. And she wouldn't have had her miracle unless she was in good stead with her neighbors. Can you imagine going to a neighbor who you just sued because their property line hit your property line and they built a fence on your property line and you got mad and sued them, and then in your time of need you would come to that neighbor and ask them for a job? What's that neighbor likely going to tell you? I'm just suing. Get the blank out of my face. I ain't giving you nothing. So you and I never know when you're going to need your neighbor to give you assistance for the trials of life. So it pays to be in good stead with your neighbors, regardless of the fact that they're Christian or not. Treat all your neighbors with love. Treat all your neighbors with kindness. When you see your neighbors, stop going astray. Offer to help your neighbor. When you see your neighbors, stop going astray. Offer to provide. Listen, I'm not a council pastor. You can speak up and show love. You don't need a council with a degree to come give God's grace and offer to pray for the spouse and offer to pray for the person. You are always God's available instrument of kindness. And as you sow the seed of kindness, the seed of kindness will come back to you one day. Say amen. And I believe that this woman got a miracle that day because she was in good stead with all of her neighbors and she went to ask for a job. They brought us, oh yeah, I remember when you helped me with that egg. Oh yeah, I remember when you gave me a camel ride. Here, here's 5 jars. Here's 7 jars. Here's 8 jars. And the Bible says she didn't just come back with 1 jar. She came back with many jars. Hallelujah. And the prophet gave her the admonition when you told her, go get some jars, and he said, and don't just get a few. She had no idea why she was going to get the jars. I don't even think she understood what the miracle was about at that point. She was just being obedient to the word of the Lord, and she went and got as many jars as she was told to get. And the thing that's so beautiful is, as she went to get the jars, the Bible said that as she poured, the oil kept flowing. But the Bible says as soon as the
sow some seed, and when you see me after church, don't do it very often, but oftentimes throughout the year, we as the church leadership team are providing opportunities for you to sow a seed. Because as you obey the word of the Lord, you don't look for the blessing as a way of sowing the seed, but you obey God. And the Bible says that as a result of you obeying God, a blessing comes. Now here's a fine line.
Here's a fine line of this picture, and I think this is where the prosperity teaches about they get it wrong.
They say, oh, I gave $100 to the Lord. Oh, I put $1,000 in the church, and the next day, I got a random cat. That's wrong. I put $10,000 in the church, and I got blessed with $500,000 business. So if you give $10,000, you're going to get $100,000 business. And they try and quantify the blessing of God, and that's wrong. That's no better than the man who saw the prophet, the men of God in the New Testament doing miracles, and they saw the miracles they were doing, and they went to the apostles and said, hey, I want that miracle that I paid you for. That's no better than doing what that guy did. What God wants you and I to do is to give when the man or woman of God speaks the word of the Lord and instructs you to give, because God wants you to be just like him. Here's how. The Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. The Oregon Coast this week, and a gospel preacher was preaching by the name of Brian Claritz, and he made this statement. God so loved the world that he gave his only son. And then he said, I got three of my sons, and I won't give any of you folks one of my son. But God had only one son, and he gave his one son for the world. That's generosity. That's love. And then he got to the Trinity, and he said, not only did God give his son, he said, Jesus Christ gave his only life. And that's generosity. And if God can give his only son, if Jesus Christ can lay out his very life on the cross, then you and I need to be like him, to be like God and Jesus, and emulate that spirit of generosity, because when we are generous, that proves that we are sons and daughters of the Most High God, because what he started in all of creation was done with a generous heart, and he expects us as his children to be generous in all we do. So here's the question. Why is it in America, this preacher went on to say, that 2% of most Americans, that most Americans only give 2% of their resources to the kingdom of God? Does that show indubitable generosity? And he said, could it be that some Christians are really not serving God for the right reason? Could it be that Christians are getting it wrong and we're holding back the blessing instead of giving a blessing? Here's what I want us to embrace. As we consider the things of God, and as we grow into the things of God, there ought to be a spirit of generosity that flows out of this church. There ought to be a spirit of love and kindness and giving, a sense of justice and compassion and mercy that flows from this church, that we care not only about ourselves, but we care about our neighbors on the street that are homeless, that are hungry, that are unemployed, and that we at times will give everything we have to help another brother or sister, or to help another person who's a stranger even, because we have the same spirit of generosity that was shown to us in God and Jesus Christ. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
And then the prophet went on to say, the speaker this week at the conference, his name's Brian Clements. He went on to say this. Could it be that Christians in America have totally missed the boat, and many of them are not saved? Because Jesus goes on to tell a story. He says, when I was sick, you fed me. When I was hungry, when I was sick, you healed me. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was in prison, you visited me. Jesus tells a story. And the people in the story go, well, when did we see you, Jesus, hungry? Because they gave you the King of Kings. You ain't never been hungry. When did we see you in prison? You didn't break no laws. We didn't come to visit you in prison, Jesus. And Jesus said, when you did it to the least of these, or you didn't do it to the least of these, you were doing it unto me. And then here's the rub. Jesus then says, there's going to be sheep and there's going to be goats. And in that last day, the final judgment day, he's going to put the sheep on the right. He's going to put the goats on the left. To the sheep on the right, the scripture is clear. He's going to say, enter into my kingdom and enjoy paradise. To the goats on the left, He's going to say, depart from me, whose work is only in me.
I know you now.
And to eternal damnation is your life. And this is the deal. The Church of Jesus Christ needs to really be sure that we are walking and living in the principle of generosity and love, because that is the key and that is the fruit of being a Christian. We're not saying that it's a work salvation, that we work our way into heaven because we fed the poor. But what we're simply saying is that if you truly are one of Jesus' servants, that you will give liberally, that you will give generously, because you are just like your Father who loved you generously. So it's time for the church to wake up to this area of giving and not look at giving your offerings in church, because the offerings you give in this church go to help people and go to promote the gospel locally and around the world. And as you give, you're giving it as unto God and into His agenda. And if you will understand that blessing and say to yourself, all my resources, Father, are in your hands. And as you bless me, I want to bless. God said, you are one of mine. And there will be some Christians and some churches who are going to be in that last day judgment experience and not receive eternal life. And I don't want that to happen to anybody here today. I don't want that to happen to any of my brothers and sisters and all of the churches around the world. And so we as gospel preachers, Pastor Paul is here. He's from another church. He's on vacation. Called me up and said he'd like to be here. I said, come on in, Paul.
Amen.
And I know Paul declares the word of God in this church. And I know there are many other pastors that are declaring the truth of God's word. And we as gospel preachers have an obligation to tell the truth. So we have told you, I told you the truth of God's word today. This woman got her blessing because she was obedient. The prophet of God was instrumental in her blessing because he was obedient and being a servant. The woman of God was a faithful woman of God because she had good relationships with her neighbors. And as a result, the oil kept flowing, and oil was a precious commodity that you could sell, just like in this age, that you can sell, that you can gain a profit from. And she had enough to last her to the end of her days. So the question is for all of us, where is your faith? Are you being obedient? Are you using your gift that God has given you? Do you have a generous heart? Are you following Jesus and willing to deny yourself and take up your cross?